The following is an encore presentation of New Expressions.
Past 10, it's New Expressions, and today we are back in the studio. Live bodies, y'all.
You know what? I just jumped on my my iPhone calendar, and it tells me that the last time that we had the full New Expressions program in the studio, guest complete, not zooming in, was the 28th of February. 2020.
Last year.
28th of February last year.
Wow.
So a little over 14 months. Oh, no, just come up to 14 months.
That's amazing.
Since we actually got to do what we do.
Yep.
And in the studio, people are listening, you'll recognize the voice. Great, great, great friend of mine and friend of this program, Pastor David Blessery from Hope You See, as the executive. We'll start there. It's like, let's roll out the functions, because you know, as executive pastor of the Hope You See churches on the Central Coast, you love the Central Coast. You're embedded in the Central Coast. You're serving the body of Christ in the Central Coast. Thank you for that. That's a great gift. When you're not doing that, or in whilst you're doing that, you've got this other hat that's on the Australian Prophetic Council, and I think also the New South Wales Prophetic Council,
but
definitely with the Australian context, so nationally. And then there's this other hat that's the Apostolic Leaders, the Coalition, Australian Apostolic Coalition for Leaders, and as a leader of Apostolic Leaders, you also function in a national and as I was hearing this morning, in international context as well, because that network is a global network.
Yeah.
So I don't know where
you left that one.
I
think you work in a flower shop too, don't you? I mean, you do everything else.
It's changed.
Throw that in there.
It's a it's a coffee shop now. He works for the Gleasons, I think. I heard.
Yeah, I like coffee. It's great.
No, keeping the Gleasons in business. That's
it's a great honor to be able to serve the body of Christ in the different mechanisms of expression. And you know, I think that in many respects, at the end of the day, I'm passionate about great leadership in the body. And what I mean by great leadership, I think that needs a little bit of definition. Great leadership looks like Jesus.
Wow.
And I think that sometimes
sometimes
that can be misconstrued, because we go great leadership and then we think, when we talk about great leadership in an organization, we think about CEOs and you know, there's things that are relevant, but there's a lot of things that don't translate. And so I'm passionate about leadership that looks like Jesus. And so in doing that, in being passionate about that, when we say words like apostle or prophet or evangelist or teacher or pastor, really, without getting anxious about any of those words, what we're really talking about is each of those are a capture of an expression of Jesus's ministry, of the ministry of Christ that we see Jesus in the Gospels operating as pastor, evangelist, teacher, prophet, and apostle. And the closer that we can, you know, men and women can walk in that grace that represents Jesus so well, that to me is what I'm passionate about. And so therefore why I do give myself, by the grace of God as well, to these spaces on the Australian Prophetic Council, on the Australian Coalition of Apostolic Leaders. And you know, I think that all of that needs to be, all ministry people that have that sort of leadership need to be anchored within a local region and love their local church.
Come on.
I'm a big advocate that all ministries, irrespective whether they're going around the globe, I always ask the question, where's home for you? Mm-hmm. What, you know, where is home for you? Where is that place that you can put your feet under the table and have authentic relationships? I think that helps us remain anchored. And so I am passionate about the nations, but you know, I'm just as passionate about the Central Coast and what God is doing on the Central Coast. And I think that giving myself to what God is doing on the Central Coast, and that's one of the reasons why I love coming into REMA, because this is one of the ministry expressions of the body of Christ on the Central Coast. I think being active in this space validates when I'm on a, you know, in a global context. You know, I was saying totally this morning, being sort of zoomed into New York. You know, it's wonderful, but actually, I even in that context, I speak about what God is doing in the region. You know, that at the home level, because none of us live in conferences, and none of us live, you know, in this. Otherwise, it feels like Big Brother to me. You know, that sort of virtual reality that and all of a sudden the conversation makes sense in a bubble, but nobody lives in that bubble.
Yeah,
you know, nobody lives in those. That high space all the time. So, yeah.
The question I think just about every listener is kind of wrestling with at the moment is, do you have five or six lives all going at once? Because, you know, just one of those ministry expressions would require of the average saint an enormous investment and really the time. And I know that you give yourself to reading. I know that you give yourself to learning. I think you've sown so much of what you're learning into my life. I've been able to increase because of that. That's been an extravagant blessing. But to be across such a rich, you know, breadth of the body of Christ and the dimensions of Christ, I think, is a very unique thing.
And but that's the beauty of Christ. And, you know, all of us carry a certain thing and we are equipped to carry a certain weight. It's not pressure to you where it would be to me and it might be to you, but you're in the same boat, Craig. I mean, you do a wide variety of things that some people are, well, I couldn't do that. There's no way I can do it. No, but there is something that you can do. You are equipped to do not just one job, but multi.
Right.
Multi-levels jobs. Yes.
Yeah. I think the way that I might capture what you're saying there is this revelation of living within divine permission. And what that means is that you walk in such a way before the Lord that you recognize the things that God has given you permission and assignment to touch, and also understanding, because when you understand that, you also understand the things that you don't have divine permission to touch. And I think as a younger man, as a younger guy, I would have said to you my life would have been more frantic and much more pressured, like what you were saying, Yvonne, there. But I wasn't touching half of what I'm touching now.
Wow.
I think it's in Luke. John the Baptist has just baptized his cousin Jesus, announced him as the Lamb of God, and then it's a little while later, not too far later, Jesus is now the disciples with him, and they're beginning to operate the ministry of baptism in the same river.
Yep.
And some of John the Baptist's disciples begin to recognize that some people have kind of are going over to the Jesus church, and aren't coming, you know, to the John the Baptist church. And they ask John the Baptist a very interesting thing, and they say, Master, are you aware that it seems that some of the crowds that were coming to us all the time and now making their way over to your cousin's church, you know? And John the Baptist says something. He says something that I just think is like an explosion to me. He says, in one of the versions, he says, a man can only receive that which heaven has apportioned to him. And I think about that a lot. I think about, that's this thing about divine permission. What has heaven, you know, if we say it this way, what has heaven allocated? What has God allocated for me to touch? And can I live in divine constraint that I'll only touch the things that I carry a witness that God has apportioned, even if some other things that I would maybe even in my heart want to do and could justify, they're going to help the church, they're going to build the body, this is going to help people. Yet that's not the issue. It's not the issue, because we can all do good things.
Yeah.
But can you live your life in divine constraint? Several years ago, I got a call from a great guy, and he's a bit of a radical guy, loves the Lord passionately, and he called me, and we were having this conversation on the phone, and somehow I began to talk about a fasted life, life.
Yep.
And I said, a fasted life is one in which you don't eat the analogy is you don't eat anything that's not apportioned to you. Yeah, and it's that thing about, can you live in divine constraint? And a funny story, because the guy who was such a beautiful guy, loved the Lord, this guy had heard the Lord speak to him about fasting, so he took the Lord literally with it, about it, started fasting on a very strict fast. I mean, it was milk and honey, you know, it was no food. But this guy had taken the Lord so literally about it that he was 2 years in. Think about this for a minute.
Yeah, right.
He was 2 years in with milk and honey.
Gee.
I mean, he hadn't eaten meat.
Yeah.
2 years. I mean, you know, I got really concerned. Pastorally,
there's only so many ways you can serve up.
So think about this. Two years. Like, I've never even gone to a doctor and asked, is this like physically possible? There was something there.
Yeah.
But somehow, what had happened was that as I began to live about talk about a fasted life, he came to a revelation, because he didn't feel a release to break the fast.
Sure.
But all of a sudden, what the thing was, he realized, he went, oh, I think God was inviting me into a fasted life. Like, that began with a natural fast.
Yeah.
He just hadn't translated it.
Yes,
and in the end, you know, was able to translate both and do it well. I think that's the key to be effective in the kingdom. Is not about loading up your schedule, and it's not about, you know, saying yes to everything.
Amen.
But it really is this thing about being aware of assignment and what is assigned to me.
Yeah.
Because at the end of the day, you know, why we want to touch assignment is because that's where the favor of God for us is.
Amen. It's your core.
It's, that's right. And because that thing's assigned to me, the favor of God is not that just that God puts my name on that project or that thing. The anointing is attracted
exactly
to the place of my favor.
Yeah.
Beautiful. The anointing is... So I'm not having to try and work this up.
Beautiful.
I think that is the key to flourishing.
Oh, that's right. Doesn't mean you're not going to go through any dirt, because I found that everything's up. You are going to go. A seed has to go through dirt.
Yeah.
To sprout. So you're that seed.
Yeah.
The moment that dirt hits you, here we go.
You'll be contented. Yeah,
yeah. That's right. But your anointing lies on your core. And that doesn't mean it's just the one thing. There are other things, but is it attached to your core? Does it work off your core? I'm big on that. If that's not part of my core, it's a hobby. As far as I'm concerned, it's a hobby.
Right.
It's got to be attached to your core, because it will really sprout some fruit there if it is.
Yes.
And as far as I'm concerned, it's got to help people.
And we're not just talking, like, let me just qualify this. I'm not just talking about divine assignment in the sense of, you know, church ministry.
Oh, no.
You know I'm talking about, you know, people finding their divine assignment in their vocations.
Yes.
Most of the work that I do with Christians in the marketplace, particularly CEOs and entrepreneurs, has to do with this particular issue.
Mm. Yeah.
And I can say to you, you know, by the grace of God now, in my client list, I have people that operate at all the echelons of enterprise, even up to, you know, several hundred million dollars a year. And I can tell you that it's no different at $200 million a year. The conversation is no different at $200 million a year as it is with a conversation with someone who's maybe working in a company as a middle manager.
That's right.
The issue is still the issue. That principle of being on assignment, what's God's vision for you in the workplace or you in your assignment? I can tell you, in the early days when I began mentoring about 10 years ago, I was mentoring some stay-at-home mums that had bubs at home, and encouraging them, saying to them, hey, God's got an assignment in this space.
Come on.
You're not in delay. You're not on the shelf until your kids grow up.
That's so good. Listen, you've sparked something. And when I was in a conversation with our good friend, Pastor Kim Jones, just yesterday, actually, and she said to me, our job is purely obedience, right? Everything else is up to him.
Yeah.
Right? Yep. You know, and it was like, actually, that's the link too, isn't it? It's like, when you were talking, all I could hear was Jesus saying, I only do what
see the Father
doing. I see the Father doing. I only say what I hear the Father say.
Yep.
And it's like, that's the divine constraint, isn't
yes,
it? Right
it is.
There, Jesus yep. showed us the way.
Yeah.
And I think that that's essentially what Pastor Kim was saying. She was saying, like, you know, we just obey. And when you're obedient,
yes.
you're in your assignment, you're in your lane, and there's grace and there's anointing. I love that. I mean, maybe I'd love to talk on that a little bit after the break.
We should,
because I think the anointing of the presence of God just shifts everything,
yes,
doesn't it?
Yes, it does. Yes, it
moves
does.
from travail and work and load and effort to a stream, to a flow.
Yes.
And,
yes.
Yeah, we got to touch on that. Amen. Pastor Dave Balestri, hope you see Executive Pastor with us at New Expressions. We are
4.9 Rima Central Coast. Let's hop back into this because, honestly, we were touching on some good stuff here that unlock a lot of things for a lot of people. Cause, I mean, we all hear the messages, you know, you can do all things. We practice strength as a man. That's cool. Yes, you can. But you do have... As we were talking off air, your own lane.
Yeah.
Right.
And you've got to actually acknowledge that, find it, tap into it with God, and then take your mindset, point at it,
yes.
and then run at it.
Right.
Because it's not going to work if you're going to the right or to the left. Right. You got to stay focused.
Yeah.
Because that's where you'll find all the good works and all the good things. But you will find some other stuff along that trail, such as milk and honey.
Yeah.
You know,
this is wonderful. Pastor Dave Balestri joining us from HOPEC. Mate, thank you so much for your time
this morning.
It's
great to be here.
What you started to uncap, you talked about divine constraint, the ability to maybe wear a whole bunch of hats, the ability to be functional in a great diversity of mission expression, ministry expression, family life expression, and so on.
Right.
Be able to be very functional in that space and effective in that space, purely because of the understanding of the voice of God, the leading of God, the assignment of God for you.
Yes.
And to be postured in that space, and then it's up to him then, really.
Yes.
You know, you be obedient, then he does what he does. And there is anointing in his favor in that. You know, leading apostles, that's hilarious. And there's got to be grace for that, I reckon.
Mm.
But I've been in the rooms where you've had some of the key leading apostles in our nation sit down together and talk in an environment where once upon a time you'd have been dreaming to think that might happen.
Yes.
So there is grace for that. And there's also, as you were rightly talking to, the function of prophet and sitting in the office of prophet as you do and being able to convene prophetic leaders and so on. I mean, it was only a few weeks back and you'd had the leader of the New South Wales Prophetic Council, Izzy Zagesany. She was up at Hope bringing an equipping
time.
Ministry and message to the saints. I was there. I loved it. I have to tell you what, being around anything where the Spirit of God is active is such a delight. And so, you know, there's these roles and this function and there's grace for this. I wonder if you could just speak for a moment into, I guess, what believers might want to understand as the anointing or understand as the grace of God to come and empower for that. Because, honestly, I think... I was having a conversation with a friend of ours, Finney, Pastor Finney from Jubilee Church last week.
Yes.
And he said to me, you know, they were in a time of great glory and activity, and just before that time, the church had felt a little dry.
Yeah, right.
And they were really slugging it out week to week, and after one of those services, he felt the Father speak to him and say, you know, Finney, what is it that happened today that only I could do? What is it that in your gathering was something only I could do? And it was like for him the wake-up call of wow, okay, he wants to
yes.
activate, he wants to release, he wants to bring transformation. And and how do we posture ourselves in that place of the empowering presence of God and the anointing? Do you want to just give us some thoughts on that for a moment?
Yeah, I think about, I think it's got to come back to this thing. If God was to come to you and say to you, I don't have any assignment for you except to just be my son, would that be enough?
Beautiful.
Would that be, like, if we're going to start anywhere, as we talk about this thought about, what if there was nothing to do? And simply the role is just be my son, my daughter, and enjoy my presence, and let me enjoy you. Would that be enough? If that was the assignment of obedience,
wow,
that's it. You know, would that be enough? And I think that from an identity perspective, that's got to be the first thing that's settled. It's right. not, you know, yeah. because otherwise, if I'm going to attach any sense of worth before the Father in what I do for Him, then we're going to put pressure on certain things, and we're going to look for an anointing for a reason that is actually not centered. And so, is it enough just to be a son and a daughter? And I think we start there, and it's yes. Okay, great.
Come on.
Then it's like, okay, now, what, Father? What are you inviting me to partner with you in? Not to do for you, all right?
Come on.
Not to do for you, because to do for you is almost to say, God, step aside. I'll do this, and then ask you to bless it. And that's not at all what this looks like. This is an invitation of the Father that says, "Hey, I've thought about you before you were born. I crafted you in a certain way that you might be a beautiful, you know, line in a song, a divine song that I'm singing through to eternity, and you're a sentence in that song. You know, because when we see that, we're actually a part of a symphony. Then at that point, see, if I'm a sentence in a part of a symphony, I don't have to try and be everything in the symphony.
Yeah, right.
And I think that sometimes what happens is that we see people, great people that we admire, doing great things, and then we kind of go, well, I could do that, or I should do that, or I should, you know, and so all of a sudden, inspiration turns into a place of distraction.
Yeah.
Because we should be able to celebrate the wonderful lines that others are singing whilst we're, you know, got our ear on the chest of the Father. And saying, Father, what is the song you want to sing through me? You know, and what if that song that the Father's singing through us, what if in the season that we're in, that song is, I want you to nurture your kids. That's you know, as a stay-at-home parent.
Yeah,
you know,
brilliant.
Is that not as valid as somebody that's in a different season or a different space, and God's asking them to unlock an injustice issue in a nation? I think both are valid, because it comes back to that thing about, well, what is it the Father's on?
Yeah.
See, if I'm, I sometimes what can happen is I can be trying to outwork even something that is a sense of destiny for me, but it's in the wrong season.
Right.
and so therefore now I'm conflicted, because I sense, God, you I know you've placed a real passion for whatever it might be upon my life, and yet it's not happening. And the question is it, are you in the right season? Are you operating in the right season? What if I know before the Lord sent me anywhere as far as to the nations, there was a massive season of sonship, of just learning to be a son, and I thought it was delay, and I thought it was the devil blocking all the doors, and I would storm heaven about that. But actually, what I failed to recognize was that the Father was just being kind to me, so that actually when I did get sent to the nation, not that that's the end all and be all, but that I was actually able to represent Him and never get lost in those opportunities, you know. They never become that. So, you know, I'm passionate, you know this, I'm passionate about the saints finding their place of assignment and rhythm before the Lord, living with that, I only do what I see the Father do, and I only say what I see the Father say, and I can celebrate somebody else living in a different chapter of their life. But each of us, I just think about, when I think about the Central Coast, I think of each church member, each ministry expression in the marketplace is part of the God's divine story for this region.
Yeah.
And I just pray that actually each of us are settled to play out the story that the Father has for us today. And I think if we can do that, what will happen, what we'll see happen in the region, is the symphony of the Father. The symphony, which is the good news, right?
Amen.
All of a sudden begins to get traction into spaces, into this region in a way that is beautiful, because it's harmonious. It's not competitive. It's not clanging. You know, it's not someone trying to play the trombone when it's not the trombone's time.
Yeah.
If we talk about this symphony, and you know, I just feel, Craig, that that to me is a real important aspect. There are the conductors of the symphony that we call them. You know, they're the church leaders, and that's why you know we absolutely, I think we have some of the most wonderful church leaders in the body of Christ here in the Central Coast. We're really blessed with them, and we're growing, and we're learning how to conduct together.
That's it.
you know how to conduct this symphony together of the saints.
No, that's a song right there. I know the saints are listening, and some will be doing cartwheels. Honestly, what a delightful thought. And thank you for your consistency. You know, it was over a year ago when you were encouraging the intercessors in the body of Christ that gather in the that what was then the Tugra prayer room, and in the upper room there, and one night you led a room packed full of intercessors who'd come to pray.
Yes,
and again the consistency of you and your station and your position, your assignment. You said to the intercessors, you know, firstly, is it enough to be a son?
Yeah.
And then important. Is it enough that the assignment might be that you get to pray the Father's heart?
Yeah, nice.
And there was a collective witness, and I think also the affirmation that you brought of the appreciation of prayer and the saints who are praying.
Yes.
You know, like, I mean, it was just life to some of those, you know, intercessors been praying in our region for decades. And faithfully, just believing God that his kingdom would come, that the reign of Christ would be established in the region and so on.
Yeah.
And to hear, you know, as you were affirming that ministry and affirming that this assignment is more than enough. This is, you know, God's on this for those who in that lane of intercession.
Yeah.
You know, likely not going to see those folks, you know, on platforms all over Europe or America. But I tell you what, faithfully in their lane, in their assignment, and doing the Father's business for him, because one ear on the chest, as you put it. What a beautiful thought.
Yeah, that coming forward of, you know, I think what one of the things prophetically that I see in the midst of, you know, the great disruption of COVID across the world, I think if we bring it, well, what's God doing in the church, you know, in this space? Well, I think that in the disruption, you know, is it in Chinese, the word crisis is the same word for opportunity. I think that there's an opportunity available to the church to really capture something of the kingdom, a kingdom structure that wasn't available in a season of rest and normalcy, you know. And I think one of the opportunities is with some of the disruption, I believe that many of the saints are really considering again the church in the city. And we realize that we need one another so much. We really do. That's not just happening amongst church, you know, church leaders, pastors, whatever. That's, you know, that I mean, I think the saints, to be truthful, I think the saints in general are probably better at it for some reason than sometimes church leaders are. And there's reasons for that. There's complications around that. But nevertheless, one of the things that I'm seeing, and I think we'll see more, is really the understanding of the body of Christ in a region, what it looks like to shoulder together the work of the Lord, this symphony. What's our part to play? What's our note to play? I think the churches will understand that, you know, many of them will understand again that they play a certain tune of, you know, culture, expression, all that, but actually they need the other. They need the other to complete the song, complete that. And I really do see some functional things happening outside of just church services, Sunday services, brilliant, great. We're now coming back to some place of restoration, of being able to do that without masks. Of course, still COVID safe, all that stuff. Having said that, I just be careful to go, oh, well, you know, the lights are back on, everything's back to normal. I don't think anything's back to normal, no, actually. I think the landscape of the future is totally altered. It was always change is always happening. What happens in a crisis is change becomes accelerated.
Yeah.
So I think what we've seen is 10 years of change in 1 year. And I think there's more to come because I, without being a doomsday about it, because this isn't a doomsday thing, but I think there's more disruption in front of us.
No, I absolutely agree.
I just think there is. And there are things that will never go back to what they were, nor should they.
Yeah.
And I think that there are things that are going to be available that weren't before.
Amen.
Yeah, we haven't seen the fallout of this yet.
No, we haven't. And, you know, we are so blessed. Australia is so blessed in that we will not be impacted in the way that many nations, I'm sure many of the listeners have been to many nations. Many nations will not look anything like they looked like when you went there last time. When we do eventually get the opportunity to travel again, I think that, you know, there's some of the nations have...
And a lot are still fighting their way out of it. Italy, France, they're still going through stuff.
They won't be where we are until 2024.
Yeah.
So just think about that. They just will not. I mean, I'm just trying to remember the nation right now that was just talking about... even the Olympics, you know, that's been delayed.
Yes.
Right? Well, so they're trying to... Yeah, we can do this. The problem is they're in the midst of a wave.
That's right.
And no one's thinking we can do this.
Well they're just... You know, they want, because there's billions of dollars there's major disruption. Mm. But actually, that's a challenge. Yeah. They're not going to be there.
Yeah. And as well as there's... As long as there's still a country that's in the midst of that wave...
Yes.
The whole entire planet still is not of it. That you have to kill it off completely.
You will. And the thing we've... You know, without getting too deep in it, we have a vaccine, we don't have a cure.
No.
And so there's a big difference between the two. And thank God for some form of a vaccine. That's a miracle. many viruses do not, that have been in the earth for decades, don't have a vaccine. There's a miraculous dimension that there is some form of a vaccine that can bring some containment to this, but we do not have a cure.
Yeah.
And so we will have to, you know, this whole thing about post-pandemic, I'm not quite sure that we'll be anywhere near that for a decade.
No.
You know, so what does the church do? How does she rally? Well, there's just some things that I think this thing about the saints being on assignment, knowing God's got a plan, you know, and the plan is always his church, by the way. So anybody that's thinking God's got another plan, it's just not there.
Plan A.
Always plan
Amen.
A. Yeah. There's no plan B.
Hasn't changed.
No, it hasn't. Faith, hope, love expressed through the lives of the saints, not only in our churches, not only through the ministry expressions of the corporate church, but through the ministry expressions of the saints in the workplace, serving the coffees, bank teller, school teacher, you know, lawyer, doctor, I mean, entrepreneur. The ministry of the saints is going to be... I think there's a pastoral opportunity for the saints. I'm talking about business owners.
Oh, yeah.
To pastor their staff well. So I'm not just talking about, you know, preaching the gospel to them. You know, I am, you know, but like St. Francis of Assisi, preach the gospel, use words if necessary.
Yes.
I'm talking about a holistic ministry. I coach a psychologist in the Netherlands who has a chain of psychology practices. Yeah. And, she is using those practices to bring great mental health, not only to her clients, but to the other psychologists through just redemptive conversations. She's quite radical, actually. Yeah. They're taking a bulk of the profits now of, hear this, in the Netherlands. She's taking a bulk of the profits and partnering with churches in the Netherlands that, they've got large buildings, but the churches, the congregations are quite small. That's just the demographic. Yeah. So the churches have got this big property with only using, you know, maybe a tenth of it.
Yeah.
And so with some of the churches, she's been able to partner with them and she's now converting some of their property into this affordable housing for mothers with children that have been through the pandemic or whatever on the verge of being evicted. And so she's
She's saying to the pastors, can you be cities of refuge? I'll fund it. Wow. Like I'll bring them, like my business, my enterprise will bring the money. And we'll also, hear this, not only will we bring the money, we'll bring the support services of the counselling and everything else and really ask what the church then becomes the community because of the geography of access to these beautiful parents and their children in a redemptive way. Mm. I'm not saying everybody should. That's her lane. That's her song.
Yeah, and I was about to say, it goes back to what you're talking about. Once you get into your core, those other things come out. It's a byproduct. Of what you do. Right. What else can I levy off this?
Yeah.
How can I leverage off this?
Right.
And boom. And it's all centered around helping people too, as well, and introducing them to Christ.
Well, just I said to her, you're doing kingdom.
Yes.
You mightn't have a pastor in front of your name. She actually has other numbers after her name. You know, because she's a brilliant, but she's got a PhD and all this. But she's standing in her lane.
Come on.
I think we're going to see a lot of this. I believe we're going to see it on the Central Coast. Some of these uniques. I talk to business people on the Central Coast. I know some of the things that are going on in a wonderful way here that are symbiotic between the marketplace and the congregation, you know, that symbiotic. I think that's one of the other things that we're going to see in the landscape of the church, you know, that's gone through this great crisis of COVID.
That's right.
These are some of the wonderful things that are coming together.
On the Central Coast. Isn't this called the Land of Giants?
Central Coast?
Come on. Kingdom Giants? I like the term you said, Doing Kingdom. We're going to have to change the name of the program, Doing Kingdom. Why not? Just a little message out there to just put something on your calendar if you can make it. There's a community meeting today at Mangrove Mountain Union Church at 4 p.m. regarding the fate of the church. Anyone interested in attending, that would be awesome. It's a community church. It's not owned by any denomination, and they just want to shoot ideas of how to keep it afloat, how to keep it going. So look, it's important if you get in there, and there isn't any other gospel type things in that region. So if you can make it, 4 p.m. today.
The Union Church, that's essentially available to different streams to come and sow into a congregation.
Right.
And I don't know if you know this, Pastor Dave is our guest in New Expressions today. I don't know if you're a guest or you're semi-regular. You're one of the team.
It's got an office. It's got an office out back, doesn't it?
I just shifted. I'm selling that thought. You're part of the team.
I'm going to add it to my portfolio. Radio
that's
host.
It. That's no, it.
I'm seconding that thought.
Let's get him a shirt. Let's get this man a shirt. They're not going to be anywhere near stylish.
I think Dave wants the shoes, not the shirt. He wants the shoes.
Right, Rima do shoes?
Oh, well, we could.
Here we go.
If he's going to get Dave in the building.
If I'm working here, then we are. We're doing shoes.
The YE Union Church.
Right.
The YE Union Church. I had cause to jump in and go and have a look at that place.
Wow.
Up in YE.
Wow.
Small little building. It's the very first church where Apostle John Alley first preached a sermon.
Is that right?
How about that? In the YE Union Church.
Okay.
And it was open to anyone to come and speak or teach, well, pastors, leaders, whatever.
Sure.
But as a young 16-year-old, someone gave him an opportunity to preach the word.
That's amazing.
And here he is as one of the senior apostolic figures in the nation now. Mm. But who would have thought?
Who would have thought?
A little opportunity at a Union Church, and there you go. Pastor Dave blessed you with us from Hope UC and also from the Australian Coalition of Apostolic Leaders, from Australian Prophetic Summit, from Council, and all sorts of other things that you do. We've been covering on that. Mate, what we were touching on just before the break was rich, and we've got lots of feedback already, listeners coming in.
Great.
And saying, look, that's such a helpful thing to hear. I'm wondering if we can just switch gear now and move into the season that we're in at the moment, where I know your heart is desperately for the region. I know that, you serve the body of Christ in the local context at Hope UC Church, but the truth is that you've been serving in the context of the Salvation Army. I mean, you have a voice into the state leader of the Salvation Army, Colonel Miriam Glewis, who you know personally, and she's, you know, appreciative of the insights that you have to help within our stream of ministry and focus and beyond that as well. But we've started this year to pray together again, kind of post-COVID sort of lockdown stuff where we couldn't gather.
Yes.
Now where we've got a little bit more freedom to gather, we've started the Central Coast Regional Prayer Network.
That's right.
And that regional prayer network is essentially a network of intercessors, prayers, saints who might be inclined to pray for our region.
Yes.
Now, you know, that you've had a bit to do with the socials, the media and so on around capturing that.
Mm.
There's a Facebook page, there's an Instagram, yes. There's a website.
Sorry, yes,
there's,
yes, that's
there's
right.
A bunch of stuff to find Central Coast Regional Prayer Network.
That's right.
But we've had Pastor Kim, a good friend of ours, Pastor Kim Jones, who's been kind of building a foundation of prayer for the saints, kind of helping us to capture what is the prayer assignment for the region. Because at the end of the day, that's the intent, isn't it? For this regional prayer initiative to capture weekly assignments in prayer.
Yeah.
She coined a phrase back at Awakening Australia of relational glory.
Right.
Relational glory, this idea that as we relate to one another, as we submit to one another out of reverence for Christ, as we, you know, cheer one another on or conspire for the success of each other and each other's ministry, as someone once put it. That's your phrase, by the way.
Yeah.
You know, as we posture ourselves that way, and as we cheer each other and pray, that there is a glory that's released. There's a dimension of oneness that is actually the glory of Christ. That the Father gave Christ this glory, and He gives to His unified body.
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes.
And John Alley, I think he wrote it like this. I think he called it Holy Community.
Yes, he did.
You know, and it's that very glory that I think was foundationally where the prayer assignments have been focused over the last few weeks, isn't it?
Yeah, that's really the foundation that Pastor Kim has been laying. You know, it comes back to that thing, you know, we were talking about, Craig, earlier in the program about the decades of prayer.
Yeah.
And you know, when I pray into this region, I feel the weight of the accumulated prayers of the saints that are at this point yet unanswered.
Right.
I think about how many decades has faithful saints in this region say been praying for revival.
Yes.
Let's say that for a moment.
Yeah.
And I think about that and I go, God, they're faithful prayers.
Yeah.
And they're not wasted prayers. I really believe that. I believe that when a prayer is yet unanswered, that's not a no. It's just stored for the kairos, you know, the season of God.
Yes.
And so the question then becomes, because sometimes when we talk about praying for a region or praying regionally, there's the notion that says, well, let's just get everybody praying. Well, that's a good thing, and it's definitely a dimension of it. But does volume of prayer alone breakthrough?
Right.
And I would suggest that it's a component of breakthrough, but it's not the silver bullet.
Right.
And then the other question is, well, what about unified prayer?
Come on.
Prayer together.
Yeah.
And again, I would say that is absolutely another component of breakthrough, though it is not the silver bullet.
Right.
And any time in the past where we've tried to make volume of prayer or just enough people praying together the unlocker, what we've seen is that by and large that's not the master key. So they're components of it. I think that one of the things that we are trying to explore, and it comes back to this thing about what does relational glory look like and what does it mean when Jesus said, Father, that they be one as we're one. You know, we come back to, again, something we said earlier in the program where Jesus said, look, I only do what I see the Father do.
Yep.
Which is really speaks to a leadership. I let the Father leads me and I follow where He leads.
Right.
So with regards to the Central Coast Regional Prayer Network, we a representation of some fivefold leaders in the city, certainly not all of them because it's impossible to do that, but a representation of them, a cluster of them, we've been meeting for several years. And as a result of that gathering together, which we gathered together to pray, to seek the face of God, you know, really what happened, we experienced, I think really, you know, we can testify here that we experienced a real melding of hearts together.
Absolutely.
and a revealing of some of the
when I say blueprints for the region, I'm really talking about God's heart for the region.
Yep.
And so the Central Coast Regional Prayer Network was the enlarging of that which had begun in that context, and the invitation of not only fivefold leaders but also the saints in general to come together and find leadership in prayer. Because I think that one of the components is not just volume of prayer, not just unified prayer, but prayer that actually captures or is in alignment with the heart and the timing of God. And that responsibility, the discerning of the heart and the timing of God,
yeah,
respectfully, biblically, falls on the fivefold leadership. That is absolutely part of their role.
Right.
And so one of the things, one of the distinctions of the Central Coast Regional Prayer Network is we're trying to figure out how to coordinate prayer through the leadership of fivefold leaders in the in a region that rally the saints to what they're discerning as the mind and heart of God for the region, for the season. And I believe it's another aspect of the breakthrough.
Wow.
You know, wow. And we launched that at the beginning of this year, and we'll explore that further into this year. So every Wednesday we have prayer initiatives that come through, and then I think it's bi-monthly we'll have a regional prayer gathering as well. And we'll let God fill in the blanks.
So just on that, because there was this week's prayer assignments got up. Pastor Phil Oldfield,
yes,
another friend of ours, has put out there the prayer call for this week for the body of Christ to be praying into.
Yes.
And next week there'll be another, yes, on Wednesday. It'll,
yes,
be
a different fivefold leader. Yep. Yeah.
And now that's on Facebook. You can find that on Facebook.
Facebook. Yep.
Or the website as well.
Yes.
Both exist. And on there you'll also find when our next regional,
yes,
prayer event.
Yeah, if you go to the social page, either Instagram or Facebook, like the page, that'll keep you up to date. Because each time, you know, we'll make sure we give you plenty of notice when we're doing physical gatherings. And I think we have one earmarked into May, and that'll come up over the next week or two. So
excellent.
Great to check that out.
And I've got to say, all I've heard from the saints is such an animation and excitement and a real joy about the dimensions of Christ represented in fivefold,
yep,
leadership that are facilitating these spaces. It's truly quite glorious. Just a footnote on John 17, Brian Simmons in the Passion Translation,
yes,
he wrote this little note. He said, "It's important to note that the key to unity among believers is experiencing the glory of God that Jesus has imparted to us."
Right.
So the glory of God that Jesus has, past tense, already imparted to us, and experiencing that.
Yes.
Experiencing that very glory, because Jesus was given that glory, yes, by the Father, and he has given that glory to the saints. Pastor Dave, would you mind just praying for us?
Love to.
Maybe that very glory that has given to the saints, the realization experience of that.
Father, we just thank you this morning, Lord, right across the Central Coast, right across every listener to this program and everyone that will listen to it afterwards in the replay. We thank you that you have, Lord, anointed us. You've placed your glory, your goodness. Yes. I love that your glory is your goodness.
Yeah.
When Moses said, "Show me your glory," God, you announced your loving kindness to him. And we thank you, Jesus, that this glory, God, inside each of the saints, yeah, will in this region continue to be unlocked and released,
yes,
Lord,
yes,
in the marketplace, in the homes,
yes,
in the neighborhoods, in the schools, in the business houses, in, yes, the shopping centers.
Yes.
God, we thank you that this glory will, Lord, announce you mightily.
Hallelujah.
Announce the faith, hope, and love of Jesus Christ. Lord, we'll see people come and, yes, overwhelmed by the good news, Lord,
yes,
as they come into salvation,
yes,
as they come into healing,
yes,
as they come into divine restoration and reconciliation.
Yes.
Lord, we bless what you're doing in the,
hallelujah,
release of this divine glory in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
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 See you next week, folks.
You've been listening to an encore presentation of New Expressions, which can be heard live every Friday morning at 10 a.m. on 94.9 Rema Central Coast.